Hello everyone. In this video, I am going to explain triaxial compression test. So first we will discuss overall procedure in short. In triaxial consolidation test, a cylindrical specimen is stressed under conditions of axial symmetry. So this is the cylindrical specimen which is stressed in triaxial test. In first stage of the test, the specimen is subjected to an all-round confining pressure, which is denoted as sigma c, on the sides and the top and the bottom. This stage is known as consolidation test. As we have discussed before, there are two stages in shear test, that is, first stage is consolidation and second is shear stage. So in consolidation stage, the pressure from all sides, that is vertical sides and top bottom, is applied. In second stage, called shearing stage, an additional axial stress known as deviator stress, sigma d, is applied. So here is an additional deviator stress on the top and the bottom of the specimen through ram. Thus, the total stress in the axial direction at the time of shearing is equal to sigma c plus sigma d. The vertical sides of the specimen are principal planes, as there are no shear stresses on the sides. The confining pressure sigma c is equal to minor principal stress, which is denoted as sigma 3. The top and the bottom planes are major principal planes. The total axial stress, which is equal to the sum of the confining pressure and deviator stress, is the major principal stress, sigma 1. Before starting with the procedure, we will understand the working of the apparatus. The apparatus consists of a circular base with a pedestal. So we can see a circular base plate at the bottom with pedestal at the center of the base plate. A specimen is fixed over pedestal. The pedestal has one or two holes which are used for the drainage of the specimen in drain test and for pore water pressure measurement in undrained test. So we can see two holes at the bottom towards the right hand side of the base plate. These are used for drainage in case of drain test or pore water pressure measurement in case of undrained test. A triaxial cell is fitted on the top of the base plate with the help of three wing nuts after the specimen has been placed on the pedestals. The triaxial cell is a perspex cylinder which is permanently fixed to the top cap and the bottom brass collar. So here is the triaxial cell. It is permanently fixed to the top cap and the bottom brass collar. These are circular in plan, but in cross sectional they are shown as two rectangles. The top cap is a branch casting with its central boss forming a bush through which a stainless steel ram can slide. The ram is so designed that it has minimum of friction and at the same time it does not permit any leakage. This ram is used to apply vertical pressure on the soil specimen. There is an air release valve in the top cap which is kept open when the cell is filled with water for applying the confining pressure. An oil valve is also provided in the top cap to fill the light machine oil in the cell to reduce leakage of water past the ram in the long duration test. So here on the top left hand side we can see an oil valve. The apparatus is mounted on a loading frame. There is again a loading cap on the top of the soil specimen on which a pressure is applied by the ram, and this pressure is transferred to the soil specimen. Different procedures are followed for the preparation of sample for cohesive soil and cohesionless soil. For cohesive soil, there is enough attraction between soil particles, hence no additional mold is required for the preparation of sample. But in case of cohesionless soil, they cannot stand of their own. That's why a special procedure is required and split mold is used for the preparation of soil, in which it is compacted and then placed in consolidation test cell. Now we will understand how the sample is prepared for the triaxial test. So in short, we are going to understand this part of the apparatus. A de-aired porous disc or stone is placed on the top of the pedestal in the triaxial test apparatus. So this is the porous disc which is placed on the top of the pedestal. A filter paper disc is kept over the porous stones. The specimen of the cohesive soil is placed on the filter paper disc. The usual size of the specimen is 37.5 mm diameter and 75 mm height. A porous stone is also placed on the top of the specimen. So here is the porous stone which is placed again on the top of the specimen. De-aired vertical strips are placed at regular spacing around the entire periphery such that this touches both the porous stones. A rubber membrane is slid over the specimen with the help of a membrane stretcher. So, rubber membrane is slid over the specimen, means the specimen is completely surrounded by the rubber membrane. This membrane is sealed to the specimen with the help of O-rings. Now let us discuss the method for the preparation of sample of cohesionless soil. As the sample of the cohesionless soil cannot stand of its own, a special procedure is used for the preparation of the sample. A coarse porous stone is placed on the top of the pedestal of the triaxial base and a pressure connection is attached to the burette. Here is the coarse porous stone which is placed on the top of the pedestal, and there is pressure connection which is attached to the burette. At the base, there is a hole at the pedestal which is connected to burette so that pore water pressure can be measured. One end of the membrane is sealed to the pedestal by O-ring. The metal former is clamped to the base. One end of the rubber membrane is sealed to the pedestal and over which metal former is clamped to the base. So here are the O-rings which are used, and this is the metal former. So rubber membrane is practically inside the metal former. The upper metal ring of the former is kept inside the top end of the rubber membrane and is held with the help of clamp before placing the funnel with stopper in position. So this is metal former, and inside it there is rubber membrane. One end of both rubber membrane and metal former is attached to the pedestal. Now the rubber membrane is stretched in such way that upper metal ring of the former is inside the top end of the rubber membrane and it is held with the help of clamp. So this is the metal ring, this is clamp, and this is funnel. There is stopper so that we can control the quantity of sand required inside the metal former or inside the rubber membrane. The membrane and the funnel are filled with deaired water. The cohesionless soil, which is to be tested, is saturated by mixing it with enough water in a beaker. The mixture is boiled to remove the entrapped air. The saturated soil is deposited in funnel with a stopper in position in required quantity. The sample builds up a continuous rapid flow of saturated soil in the former. The funnel is removed and the sample is compacted if required with the help of glass rod. The surface of the sample is leveled and porous stone is placed on its top. Loading cap is placed on the top of the porous stones. O-rings are fixed over the top of the rubber membrane. Once the cohesionless soil is filled inside the metal former, it is then consolidated. For that, a small negative pressure is applied to the sample by lowering the burette. The negative pressure gives rigidity to the sample and it can stand without lateral support. As soon as the negative pressure is applied, the consolidation of the sample occurs and it slightly shortens. Generally, the diameter of the upper porous stone is slightly smaller than that of the specimen, so that it can go inside when the sample shortens. Otherwise, a neck is formed. The split mold is then removed and the diameter and the height of the sample are measured. The thickness of the membrane is deducted from the total diameter to get the net diameter of the sample. The cell is then placed over the base and clamped to the base. Then it is filled with water. Now let us start with the test procedure for the triaxial compression test. Now there are again two stages. First stage is consolidation stage and second stage is shearing stage. Now let us discuss first test, that is consolidation stage. This stage is eliminated in case of unconsolidated test. But if there is unconsolidated drain test or consolidated undrained test, the following procedure is practiced. A triaxial cell is placed over the base and fixed to it by tightening the nuts. The cell is then filled with water by connecting it to the pressure supply. Some space in the top portion of the cell is filled by injecting oil through the oil valve. The oil is injected so that the leakage of the water from the ram area can be prevented. When excess oil begins to spill out through the air vent valve, both the valves are closed. Pressure is applied to the water filled in the cell by connecting it to the mercury pot system. As soon as pressure acts on the specimen, it starts consolidating. The specimen is connected to the burette through pressure connection for the measurement of volume changes. The consolidation is completed when there is no more volume changes. Now let us come to second stage, that is shearing test. When the consolidation is complete, the specimen is ready for being sheared. The drainage valve is closed. The pore water pressure measurement device is attached to the specimen through the pressure connections. The probing ring dial gauge is set to zero. Using the manual control provided in the loading frame, the ram is pushed into the cell but not allowed to touch the loading cap. The loading machine is then run at the selected speed. The probing ring records the force due to friction and the upward thrust acting on the ram. The machine is stopped and with the manual control, the ram is pushed further into the cell, bringing it in contact with the loading cap. The dial gauge for the measuring axial deformation of the specimen is set to zero. The sample is sheared by applying the deviator stress by the loading machine. The probing rings readings are generally taken corresponding to axial strains of 1/3%, 2/3%, 1%, 2%, 3%, 4% and so on until failure or 20% axial strain. Upon the completion of the test, the entire assembly is dismantled and the water content of the specimen is found. Once the test procedure is completed, the stress-strain curve can be plotted for this given specimen, where values of stress are obtained from the pressure we have applied, that is deviator stress, by the loading machine, and value of strain is obtained from the readings of probing ring. Again, this test is repeated at least twice for different specimen of the same soil and using different cell pressure so that different value of deviator pressure will be obtained at failure. So, using this value, a failure envelope can also be obtained and Mohr circles can also be drawn. This representation of the result we will be discussing in our one of the next slides. Thank you.